Hello, my name is Lloyd de Beer. I'm a curator of late medieval European collections here at the British Museum. And welcome to my corner. So I'm currently curating an exhibition, Thomas Becket, Murder and the Making of the Saint, here at the British Museum. And we have some extraordinary treasures in this show. We've got golden reliquary caskets. We've got Magna Carta is in the exhibition. And we've also got an entire stained glass window from Canterbury Cathedral, a 6 meter tall window. And I could have picked any of those objects to talk to you about today, but I didn't. I picked these three objects to talk to you about. These three little unassuming pieces of metal. And the reason I picked these objects is because I think that these objects are as interesting as all of those sparkly, glittering, shiny objects, and they can tell us as much about the cult of Thomas Becket, but we need to do a little bit more work and we need to look a little bit more closely at them. The Becket story is extraordinary, this stratospheric rise, fall, exile, and eventual murder in the cathedral. But it's what happens after Becket dies that is really extraordinary. Because within days, probably the very night of his murder, miracles start happening. So much blood was spilled when Becket was killed that they collected up a lot of the blood. But a lot of people also did things like dip their fingers in the blood or dipped cloth into the blood. And it's some of these bloody cloths and it's some of this blood that is responsible for some of the earliest miracles. For instance, a man takes home one of these bloody cloths and he dips it into a drink and gives it to his sick wife and she's healed from the drinking of this liquid. And it's these stories that start to circulate that people pay attention to and they realize that something very special is happening at Canterbury and they start to go to Canterbury. They want to get access to Becket's blood for healing. And that's where this object comes in here. And this was bought at Canterbury by a pilgrim and it was filled with a liquid called St. Thomas's water, which was a mixture of water diluted with Becket's blood. We know it was that because on the front of the object here, we can see the martyrdom scene, Becket's murder, in miniature detail. So what we have here is we have four knights, and then slightly strangely, we have these two giant heads just here and just there behind. And they either show Becket twice, so they either show Becket kind of bowing his head down as the first knight drives the sword into his head, or they show Becket and an associate who is there at the murder, a man called Edward Grimm, who was one of the only people who actually stayed to defend Becket from these knights, who also got his arm chopped into by another one of the knights during the kind of fracas. You might be thinking, hang on, I've never heard of a religious or a Christian cult where they drank the saint's blood. And you'd be right, because this was one of the only ones. And it freaked people out. And so in a sense, the drinking of Becket's blood was a little bit like the drinking of Christ's blood. But the monks watched what was happening. They gave people this diluted mixture. It seemed to be working. And in the end, they were kind of okay with it. I mean, they were clearly okay with it because they were doshing loads of this stuff out. And this isn't just one or two miracles that happened connected to Becket. There are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of miracles attributed to Becket. More miracles than any other saint at the time. You know, the miracles are extraordinary. They're miracles of people's sight being repaired, of people's genitalia coming back. They are of people who couldn't walk being able to walk again. And one of them is about a woman where a worm falls out of her face. And it's because she's eaten cherry pits. And so Becket makes these cherry pits come out and then a worm comes out of her face. And I think the miracle's called something like concerning the woman from which a worm came out of her face. At first, pilgrims were just taking their own boxes to Canterbury, and they were taking these wooden boxes. And what's amazing is we're told that these could not contain the power of the water, that the water of Becket was so strong that it would break open these wooden boxes, it would break open these ceramic boxes. A local man in Canterbury decided to make these flasks, which are called ampulla, in lead, in tin alloy. We're told that it was by divine will that he came up with these flasks that would not split, because these could contain the water. But the really important thing that Benedict tells us is that these could also be worn as a sign of the pilgrim's journey so that all could see they had been to Canterbury. So you might be wondering, did they run out of blood, or how much blood did they have? Well, amazingly, in the miracle stories, Becket's miracle stories, there are these blood miracles where the blood reproduces. And so a local church in Canterbury asks for some of the blood, and the monks give a tiny little scraping that they put into a flask that they give to the church. The priest of the church takes the blood home and in the morning wakes up to see that the small scraping of blood had turned into an overfilling jar of blood. It's very good business to never run out of the thing that everyone is coming to your place to get. Pilgrimage is not a monolithic thing. It changes constantly. And in Becket's case, I think there is a shift from the drinking of Becket's water, from the purchasing of these ampulla, to badges, to other kinds of objects that can be worn on the body. But the badges are doing a completely different kind of thing. And what they're doing in this instance is they're telling us a story that's not just the story of the murder, but is also the story of Becket's life. So this object that I have here, which is a very delicate badge, this shows Becket sitting on top of a horse. So why is Becket on a horse? Well, one thing that happens to Becket is that he goes into a prolonged exile abroad. He returns to Canterbury on the 2nd of December 1170, and he returns and rides back to Canterbury triumphantly. And so here we've got an image of Becket returning from exile and riding triumphantly back into Canterbury. So what does that tell us? Well, it tells us that pilgrims were really interested in identifying with parts of the Becket story that earlier on, with the ampulla, with the flasks, they weren't as interested in. And the horse is so beautifully rendered with all of these little circles and these little dots, and you can see horse harness equipment. And then Becket is shown in incredible detail, wearing his archiepiscopal clothing, wearing a mitre, carrying a cross-shaped staff. And so it really is, I think, a really magnificent little object. One thing that happens is in 1173, when the Pope Alexander III canonizes Becket, is he decrees that Becket's body should be moved to a much better site, because after the murder they put him in a tomb in the crypt of Canterbury Cathedral. But this isn't really good enough for a saint of Becket's standing. So what do? Well, they decide that they're going to make a new shrine. But before they're able to do that, the east end of Canterbury Cathedral burns to the ground. But they also use it as an opportunity to rebuild Canterbury Cathedral on an even greater scale and place Thomas Becket's shrine at the very center of their plans, because he's their new mega saint. This takes about 50 years, but on the 7th of July, 1220, they move the body of Thomas Becket from the crypt of Canterbury Cathedral into this new shrine, and this shrine is amazing. The base is a pinky white marble, and on top of this base is a golden reliquary casket that's covered in gems and jewels and rings and brooches and all kinds of treasures that people are giving to Canterbury Cathedral. And the badge I'm going to show you now is a miniature version of that shrine. What we see is a kind of architectural frame around the outside of the badge. And then at the very top of the badge, we see this casket covered in these little blobs, these little dots to represent gems and jewels. In the very middle, we see an image of a tiny Becket reclining in the shrine with his hands in prayer and his crozier to his side, his staff to his side. And then underneath we have these little architectural niches, and these are the things that pilgrims would go and bow down before and stick their heads in to pray. What drew me to these objects, why I love these objects so much, is that in a sense I've always been drawn to the lesser object, the one that you might easily pass by in a gallery at the British Museum and not give a second thought, but that when you do, reveals so much more than you ever thought you could derive from an object like this. I mean, you can see from some of the ones I've shown you today, these are very damaged objects. They're hard to interpret. I mean, even in the galleries, they're hard to light. And so, for me, there's something about looking closely at them and promoting them a little bit to say, hey, every object at the British Museum is potentially a star object. Every object has a story to tell, and every object can reveal so much to us if we just spend a little time with it and think about what it meant. The other thing about these objects that really appeals to me is that so much of what we know about objects in the Middle Ages, certainly things like that gold cup just behind me, for instance, is that they're made by kings or by queens or by very important noble people. But these objects were purchased by ordinary people who otherwise leave no trace. And so they connect us to a whole group of individuals from the past who we really have no other access to other than these kinds of remains. So we've got an exhibition on about Thomas Becket right now called Thomas Becket, Murder and the Making of a Saint. It's filled with amazing things. Stained glass, manuscripts, reliquary caskets. If you want to learn more about the life, death, and legacy of Thomas Becket, you can buy tickets right now by clicking here.